more. You know, just want to, you know, talk to you about this book I wrote about this very famous and controversial, very tragic case in Lancaster, in which a young girl, Laurie Show, was senselessly murdered in 1991. You know, first of all, can I ask how many people, I'm just trying to get a feel, how many people are very familiar with the case? Is that right? Okay, I wasn't sure if, when I did a talk in Exton a few months ago, and I kind of expected that people would have a familiarity, and many, many did not. So, did you guys come just because true crime interests you?
The Amish are interesting, native in the area.
Okay. All right, you know, because I want this to be interactive, you know, I want you guys here to please ask questions and any comments whatsoever, please come in. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'll try to finish my master's at the University of Valley Forge. I'm writing my thesis, and I'm coming across a lot of new books that are being written, and sometimes it's hard to know how to present information, so it's a discipline that you must have mastered, so I'm just not curious, but just want to understand a little more of the process of how you can take information and present it to the public. It's not easy to do.
No, I appreciate it.
Are you an attorney?
I am.
Okay.
And I don't think I've mastered the art of writing, but I, you know, at least I have fun
I thought maybe you would have been an attorney.
Yeah, I'm a workers' comp lawyer, and I mean, even though this involves a high-profile murder case, I'm not a criminal lawyer.
How long did it take you to write it?
Yeah, I mean, it was over a period of 4 or 5 years, you know, and a lot of it is, you know, full-time job in Center City, Philadelphia, and I'm married with three young kids, and you know, it was time consuming, and you know, initially, and then let me just, if I'll get into a little bit of how I came to write it. I'd written some sports books before, always passionate about sports, mostly with the Phillies theme. I wrote a book about Steve Carl, the great pitcher, and you know, a few other Philly related books, and I had followed this case got huge amounts of publicity in the 1990s. You know, this, you know, Amish country, young girl gets brutally murdered. That's horrible. And then, you know, three people get arrested for it. And you know, Lisa Lambert, the woman that I wrote the book with, I mean, they saw the death penalty against her, and she was convicted of murder and did not get the death penalty, but got a life sentence with no parole. And you know, 5 years later, her conviction was thrown out by a federal judge in Philadelphia on the basis that there was misconduct by the prosecutors and the police. And she walked free, and she was free for less than a year, and then an appeal was filed by the Commonwealth on the basis that, and this is like a technical legal argument, but to get free, her lawyers filed in federal court in Philadelphia, and the federal appeals court said that it was necessary for her to raise her issues in the state court in Lancaster before going to the federal court in Philadelphia. So it was really a very much a technical legal argument. But the appeals court was convinced that yes, she should have gone to state court first, so that vacated the opinion of the decision of the federal judge and went back to prison, and she had no choice but to go back to Lancaster. And then she had another hearing, and the same judge who presided over her original trial in 1992 presided over this, you know, post-conviction hearing in 1998 actually. And I mean, it's a very politically charged case, and you know, the whole subject of what I think are wrongful convictions. I mean, it's interesting to me because, you know, there's so much, you know, so much pressure on the police to solve crimes and, you know, convict people who, you know, convict murders and who commit murders. And I think there's just a lot of pressure, and especially in a highly publicized case like this. And I think there was a lot of pressure on the judge in Lancaster to make sure that she, you know, she was convicted again, and she was. And then, you know, subsequent appeals were filed, and, you know, all failed. And then so in, you know, I've written these sports books, and then I'm looking to do something different. And then in the 2011 time frame, you know, I just always wondered about her. You know, she had been in prison. You know, she was, when she was convicted of this murder, I mean, she had just given birth to a baby, a 3-month baby. So, you know, that was, and, you know, she was 19 years old, and, you know, and 20 years had passed. And, you know, so she got moved around. I mean, she was abused by some prison guards in Pennsylvania, so they moved her to New Jersey, and then she had, you know, inmates were roughed her up, and she and her parents wrote a lot of letters, and she ended up getting moved to Massachusetts, and that's where she has been since 2006. And the prisons were more liberal up there. I mean, she's, you know, I visited her a few times, and she was able to get her college degree in prison, which is, you know, which is a great thing for Boston University. The professors actually, you know, came to the prison, and, you know, she graduated, and, you know, she wears regular, you know, regular clothes, jeans and a t-shirt. She doesn't have the prison garb that most prisoners around the country are required to wear. But you know, I had written her a letter, having no idea if she would be, you know, interested at all in, you know, in a book being written about her case. But, you know, she was receptive, and, you know, we just started, you know, writing letters back and forth, and, you know, and it, you know, decided to, you know, to write this book. And, you know, I found very quickly that she writes quite well herself. And, you know, since it was such an undertaking to write the book, we decided that it would be a collaboration. So she wrote, you know, probably 3/4 of it, and I wrote chapters just kind of analyzing the legal issues in the case and the political issues. And so, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, and that's the way we did it. And so in other words, you folks don't know anything about the nuts and bolts of the case at all.
She's still in prison.
She is. So, I mean, 45 years old.
And she's declaring innocence.
Yeah. She, what, you know, and just to give you some of the details about, you know, what happened. So she, I mean, Lisa grew up in the Lancaster area, you know, strict parents, and she was a rebellious teenager and dropped out of school at one point. Even though she was very smart, she dropped out of school, and then she started again, and she ended up going out with a, you know, a guy who was just physically and emotionally and sexually abusive towards her, and she put up with it like a lot of, you know, women do. And, you know, just even though their self-esteem is getting battered, so she stuck with this guy, and then there was a breakup, and this was 1989. She's just a 16-year-old girl, and this guy's name is Lawrence, or nicknamed Butch, and they went out for a couple of years. They moved in together, and there was a time when they broke up, and this is the summer of 1991. This girl Laurie Sho, who becomes the victim in this case, briefly dated Lawrence or Butch, and during that time he was just a really violent guy. I mean, he date raped Laurie, and she filed a, you know, a report with the police, and you know, and they just went out a couple times, and then that was it. And but Lisa was, I guess as young girls can be, was jealous that her boyfriend, even though the boyfriend's abusive, she was still jealous that he had gone out with this other girl a couple of times. And, you know, and if they would see each other at the mall or something, they would argue, and there was, you know, allegations of some nasty phone calls and things like that. And there was, you know, there was talk about, Lisa talked about with other friends of, you know, pulling a prank on Laurie. Laurie had long hair and pulling a prank and cutting her hair off and, you know, humiliating her. You know, just stupid, stupid teenage stuff. But then what ended up happening is on December 20th of 1991, you know, there was a plan, and the big, you know, area of dispute in this is who really hatched the plan, who was the mastermind. But there was Lisa and Lawrence had become friends with a girl named Tabitha, who was 17 years old, Tabitha Buck. And there's no dispute that early in the morning, like 7 o'clock a.m., they drove over, Lawrence and Lisa and Tabitha drove over to Laurie's condo. And Laurie was the only child of her parents, John and Hazel Show, who were divorced. And Laurie lived with Hazel. And there was a phone call made the day before that was allegedly from the guidance counselor at school telling Mrs. Show that, hey, I need to meet with you to talk about Laurie. I have some concerns. So Mrs. Show left the house at about 7 o'clock. And Lawrence dropped off Lisa and Tabitha about a quarter mile from this neighborhood, and they went to the door, and you know, one of them had a knife. I mean, very terrible stuff. There's no excuse for this. And the long and short of it is Laurie ended up getting brutally murdered, and it's horrible. And stabbed, and you know, there's a rope. But the big what I have always, what Lisa has maintained, and what I always believed is that they went into the condo to, you know, pull this prank and cut Laurie's hair off. Again, foolish. I mean, it's still it's a felony to go into somebody's house and, you know, cut their hair off, but it's, you know, it's not the same as murder. And what Lisa said is that Tabitha all of a sudden became violent and started, you know, wielding the knife. And Lisa's like, I don't want any part of this. And she vacated the condo and went to the stairwell. And Lawrence, who had, you know, again, dropped them off a few minutes earlier, he comes running up the stairwell, and he goes in, and he and Tabitha, you know, murder Laurie. And but what the prosecution always maintained, and the evidence to me is overwhelmingly against it, is that Lawrence never entered the condo. This was just Tabitha and Lisa, but Lisa was the ringleader because Lisa was jealous. Lisa was jealous because Laurie had gone out with her boyfriend briefly over the summer, and she was cast as the, you know, as the villain here. And the big piece of evidence that really contributed to her conviction, just highly controversial, is that Lisa was her first name. Her middle name was Michelle, Lisa Michelle Lambert, and Lawrence, her very overbearing boyfriend from the beginning, insisted that he call her Michelle. Nobody'd ever called her Michelle. She always went by Lisa, but he wanted to call her Michelle. And that's what he did, and that's what kind of people and the friends started calling her Michelle. And what Laurie's mother said is that when she got back, if she gets back, this is this fake call to get her to go over to the school. And somebody in the group made this call. And I mean, I think it was Tabitha, and the authorities think it was Lisa. But when Laurie's mother came back to the condo, she walks in, and her, you know, daughter has been brutally beaten and is, you know, has gaping wounds to her neck and is on the brink of death. And according to Mrs. Show, that right before she died, her daughter said, you know, in a raspy voice, you know, Michelle did it. And, you know, in a court of law, that's technically hearsay because it's coming from somebody else and that person can't be cross-examined. But one of the exceptions to the hearsay rule is a dying declaration. And if, you know, if somebody makes a statement on the brink of death, it's said to be reliable and, you know, therefore, you know, that, that was allowed into evidence. And, you know, that was kind of the linchpin of the prosecution's case, that, you know, that the, you know, the girl that got murdered, you know, fingered Lisa as the murderer. But the reality of it is there was so many, you know, instances, you know, to me and to this federal judge who released Lisa Lambert, that the police did not, that they really railroaded her. They had their sights on her. Lawrence, who I'm convinced was the mastermind behind this, was given initially a plea agreement for a 1-year sentence for what's called hindering apprehension, in other words, for just disposing of evidence. But there was an absolute mountain full of evidence that supported the notion that Lawrence was actually in the condo and participated in the murder. He did not merely just drop them off a quarter mile away and then pick them up a quarter mile away, like he said. You know, things like he wore earrings. His earring back during the autopsy was found in Laurie Show's hair. Now, if that's not a smoking gun, I don't know what is. You know, if that doesn't put him in the condo, nothing does. And, you know, this is kind of the beginning of when DNA became, really utilized. And it's unsure whether DNA was ever done. But that, you know, that earring back found in her hair, and then the authorities say they lost it, it disappeared, and to me is highly suspicious. And I think they knew that supported the notion that Lawrence, the boyfriend, was there and guilty, and supported Lisa's story that when she said that he in fact did come into the condo and she was not there. And there were several other examples. I mean, a couple, 3 days, Lisa told authorities, look, one of the things we did is we got rid of, Lawrence was a big guy, like 6'1", 6'2", 200 pounds. He had very, you know, size 12 feet, and he had bloody sneakers because he went into the condo, and they got rid of the sneakers. They threw them in a bag, and then they went to the Susquehanna River and threw it in the river. And, you know, in the couple, 3 days after the murder, the authorities did a search at the river, and they claimed that they didn't find anything. But then, you know, 5 years later, when Lisa got her filed this appeal in federal court and had some real heavy, heavy hitting lawyers, on her side, they were able to get the original videotape of the search of the river, and it showed that in fact they did find a bag that contained this bloody sneaker. But they admitted that it was a 12-minute tape, but they admitted 4 minutes of it, and to try to show, oh, look, we found nothing nothing in this river search, when in fact they had found a bloody sneaker that implicated Lawrence. And, you know, think about this: a girl has been brutally murdered, and the police is supposed to do their due diligence. 3 days after, they find significant evidence and don't turn it over. There had to be something had to be motivating them to do it. They wanted to finger Lisa, and they wanted, Lawrence was their star witness who was gonna say that he drove the girls to the, and that they committed the murder. And So, you know, there were just, you know, there were numerous other examples of that, of misconduct that, you know, yes, please.
What happened to Tabitha, her cohort?
No, no, very, I mean, very good question. Tabitha was, Lisa's trial was first, July 1992. And, you know, again, they sought the death penalty against her. And, it was, the publicity in Lancaster was just awful. I mean, everybody, and I think people tend to do that, you know, and in a high-profile case, they will read snippets in the newspaper and the news, and Lisa Lambert is being depicted as the murderer, and people believe that without knowing all the evidence. And one of the things her lawyer did was file a motion for a change of venue, which I think really absolutely should have been granted. I mean, she should have, you're entitled to an impartial jury, listens to the evidence, and doesn't have any preconceived notions. But the judge, this is Judge Stengel, a very young judge, not even 40 years old, only been a judge less than 2 years, wasn't even a lawyer very long, you know, presiding over this very high-profile case, denied the motion for the change of venue. And I mean, I believe, in a point that I made in the book, is I think that he wanted to keep the case in Lancaster and just to, you know, to do everything he could to ensure a guilty verdict. And Lisa's lawyer recommended that she take a very unusual step and waive her right to a jury trial. You know, most criminal defendants opt for, you're entitled, you know, under the Constitution to a, you know, to a jury trial. 12 people have to find you guilty for you to be convicted. But her lawyer told her, listen, if you do that in Lancaster, that not only are they going to convict you, they are probably going to sentence you to death. So you were better off just giving up your right to a jury trial and just having your case heard by a judge. And then, even though the thought was that Judge Stengel was biased, that her lawyer, whose name was Roy Shirk, thought that, I mean, he was a Catholic man, and he thought, the lawyer thought, the judge would be less inclined to impose the death penalty on her. And that's exactly what happened. He convicted her of the murder, did not give her the death penalty, but gave her a life sentence with no parole. And, Lisa testified at her trial at length that, and again, telling the consistent story that she used bad judgment by going over there in the first place, but she did not participate in the murder. And I have always thought, you know, in all the, you know, the books I've read and TV shows I've watched and all the cases I've followed, that people who are really guilty tend not to testify, and people that are innocent are more likely to testify. I mean, I don't know if the research supports that, but I strongly believe that. And Lisa was willing to testify on her own behalf. And you ask about Tabitha, her lawyer filed a motion for a change of venue, and it was granted. And her case did not. I mean, even though she was part of this whole murder, most of the bad publicity was aimed towards Lisa. But Lisa was the one that was most deserving of a different venue. She didn't get it. Tabitha did. And 2-3 months later, they had her trial in Easton, and she opted not to testify. And again, supports my theory that the guilty just, you know, keep their mouths shut. And she was convicted of murder as well, and she got a life sentence without the possibility of parole. However, there was a significant development in her case. When the murder happened, Tabitha was 17, Lisa was 19. Lisa was a year and 3 months past her 18th birthday. Lawrence was 20. And as I'm sure you folks have heard, the, you know, U.S. Supreme Court issued a decision in recent years saying it's unconstitutional to have mandatory life sentences for juveniles because, you know, they're considered children and they're, you know, their brains are not fully developed and they're capable of being rehabilitated is the theory. And so Tabitha got a new sentencing hearing last year. Now she, you know, she has been in prison herself since this happened in the December of 1991, but the judge gave her the opportunity for parole in either the 28 year mark or the 30 year mark. So within 2 or 3 years, she will in all likelihood be out of prison. Lawrence, the irony is that he, again, he's the mastermind. He date raped the victim. He had the rape charges had not been, but could have been brought against him. I think he had every motive to want to harm Laurie. He cooperates with the authorities. He's given this, as I told you, this deal of just 1 year in prison, but because the prosecution felt that he had lied at Lisa's trial about a certain issue. When Lisa and Lawrence were awaiting trial, they were in the same Lancaster County prison and they were able to exchange letters. And Lisa sent Lawrence a series of questions, and it became known in the case as the 29 questions. She just you know, asked him questions like, you know, things like, you know, if I, and it's clearly the words of a battered woman, you know, if I cover up for you, Lawrence, will you always love me? You know, those kinds of things. And some of the questions she asked were, you know, don't you feel bad about you and Tabitha killing Laurie? And several questions like that. And Lawrence had such control over her, he thought that there was no way she would ever, you know, release his answers to her questions. But he answered many of these questions, clearly stating that yes, he and Tabitha did commit the murder, and he will always love Lisa, but she wants him to cover up for him. And, you know, I mean, it is really awful stuff. But because the prosecution thought that he had lied at Lisa's trial about that document, these 29 questions, they threw out his plea agreement. They revoked it. They gave him the opportunity to take a lie detector test with regard to his testimony concerning these questions. He failed that lie detector test. And they're not, lie detector tests, I agree, are not 100% accurate, but nevertheless, the prosecution considered that. And he ended up, I mean, even though I really think they should have brought first degree murder charges against him, they gave him a deal for third degree murder, 10 to 20 years. He was paroled after 12 years. So then the murder happens in 1991. He is out in 2004, and he's living the life, and, you know, in suburban Lancaster and married with kids. And, you know, so he is out. Tabitha's going to get out. And, you know, Lisa, who I believe had the least involvement in the matter, you know, has a life sentence, and it's very, very difficult to. Yes, please.
Is she resigned to that life, or is she still trying to get it reversed?
Very good question. She is definitely not resigned to it. I mean, she definitely. When I first sat down with her, you know, this is 7 years ago, June of 2011, you know, I asked her, you know, do you get used to this life? And she says, no. I mean, I never, I've always hated it. I've always felt like I don't belong here. And has fought valiantly to get her conviction overturned. And it is just the thing is, it is so hard to get a conviction overturned, especially this many years
sure.
after the fact, unless there's some newly discovered evidence, and there's certain exceptions that you have to meet to get that evidence to be heard.
I guess DNA at this juncture is kind of the question.
Well, I mean, you know, one of the things we thought was that, you know, if that, we suspect that maybe that earring back that I told you about that was found in Laurie's hair, possibly the prosecutor sent that out to be DNA tested, and it had Lawrence's DNA.
All over it.
Yeah, and then they said, "Oops, we better get rid of this."
Oh, Lord.
So now we don't know that. We suspect that that may have happened. Now, would that, if we were able to find that in fact that was DNA'd, and they did not turn those results over, that's a possible basis. But yeah, please.
The human mind and spirit and soul is mysterious, and I'm trying to figure out what you're saying and you know what you've been told, or was the justice system afraid of Lawrence, of what he could do? What was his track record? Was he into drugs or narcotics? And I do not understand the Lancaster area. I'm originally from the Pittsburgh area.
Right.
I just kind of smell an aroma of dirt, of a payoff. I don't know what words to use, but I smell a rat.
I mean, I certainly agree. And I have, you know, throughout this process, I've actually not met Lisa's mother. Lisa's mother and father were married for 35 years and went through a nasty divorce, very nasty, about 10 years ago. And I've had a lot of contact with her father, and a really nice man, very supportive. And that's one thing that he has mentioned many times, that there had to have been something at play, something politically, some connection for them to bend over backwards for him so much.
There was a payoff somewhere, somehow, something.
And I think, you know, he had, you know, here's this 20-year-old guy, and the family did not, you know, come from money, and yet he had a private lawyer representing him. You know, Lisa was just appointed a public defender, and it was always suspicious where they would have gotten the money to pay this lawyer, and I know that there was some question about Lawrence's actual father. I mean, he was raised by his mother and then his brother's husband, but there's question who the real father is. Lisa's father suspects that might have something to do with it. But you know, that's, if there were connections.
Did you feel safe writing this? I mean, you put yourself in jeopardy.
Why
did you do it?
Well, I mean, I just felt passionate about it, and you know, I really thought that, you know, I do. You know, I'm a workers' comp lawyer, and look, I mean, I like to help people out that get injured at work, and I feel bad if somebody has a workers' comp claim and they're denied benefits, and it's a financial burden, and the insurance company is, you know, screwing them. But look, that just involves, you know, money, and you know, money is, I know you need it to survive, but it's just not the same thing as your freedom, and especially, you know, when you're talking about a life sentence. And I've just seen, you know, too many cases over the years. I mean, it's really on my radar, but you just, if you're, you know, you look at the news, it's so often that people are found to be wrongly convicted and spend 10, 20, 30 years in prison.
Many, was your life threatened after writing this?
No. I mean, I haven't had any.
Do you live near?
I live.
In Lancaster?
I live in downtown. Yeah, I'm just down the road. So, yeah, I mean, I stay.
That took courage for you to do that.
Thanks. I mean, I just felt like, you know, I felt like I, you know, really wanted to do it.
Nobody questioned about the shoes that they found, supposedly, and then they lost them, or?
Say it again?
The shoes. You said there were bloody shoes that were thrown into the river?
Well, I think that's what, at the subsequent federal, you know, again, the 1990, the chronology is incredibly complicated. It's the 1992 trial, there was not the shoes were not known because they weren't turned over. But then Lisa's lawyers do, you know, with their diligence, they're able to find out about this, that they, these shoes were recovered. And it, that was one of the things that contributed to Judge Dalzell. You know, Judge Dalzell is, you know, he's a recently retired federal judge, very, very articulate and very, you know, very impartial. He's a Philadelphia judge. He had no connection whatsoever to Lancaster, and he didn't have any, look, all judges, they have their biases, you know, they just, where they grew up, just whatever their life experiences were, that's the reality of it. And he's really a conservative Republican judge, but you know, he when he wrote his decision releasing Lisa, like a 55-60 page decision, it was the most blistering judicial opinion I've ever read. I mean, he just was viciously critical of the Lancaster authorities, and yeah, I mean, that's one of the things, the sneaker, I mean, there were just many pieces of evidence that came to light during this appeal that, you know, he just unequivocally concluded that Lawrence was the, you know, was the mastermind behind this. And but again, it was incredibly, when it went back to Judge Stengel in Lancaster, he just glossed over the wrongdoing, minimized it, put his own spin on it, and Lisa's just the worst person, you know, you'd ever want to be.
Did Lisa, oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
I was just curious, you said she had a 3-month-old child. Was that child Lawrence's child?
Yes. I mean, yes. The baby was born in March. In other words, the murder occurs December 1991. She's 6 months pregnant. She's arrested, charged with murder, death penalty sought against her. She has the baby, you know, when she's in jail, you know, transported to the hospital in March. And she, Lawrence was indeed the father. And they, you know, there was a custody hearing a couple of years later, and Lisa and her parents were successful in getting Lawrence stripped of all parental rights. And Lisa's parents raised the daughter Kirsten, who's now, you know, in her 20s. You know, obviously Lisa's relationship with Kirsten is extremely strained. I mean, you know, you just can't raise a child when you're in prison. You know, you can't do it.
What did she get her degree in?
Liberal studies is, you know, just, and I mean, I think if she was on the outside, she could probably have gone to law school. I mean, she really has that kind of mind, and smart woman, good writer. And, but go ahead.
Well, I was just thinking, Lisa's saying she had nothing to do with the actual murder.
That's correct. I mean, she agrees that she went over there in the first place, which was wrong. I mean, she should have gotten some, much as I, you know, passionate about her case, I admit, she absolutely should have gone to prison for some period of time.
Okay, now, there couldn't be DNA, her DNA, on this poor soul's body because she wasn't there.
Well, that's true.
The only DNA that was possible was the earring thing. Is that, well, let's say whoever it was that actually, you know, when you're, not that I've ever stabbed anyone,
you're right,
but when you're in a position where you're stabbing somebody, you've got to be leaving pieces of your, flakes of your skin and all over the place. And
they gotta be strong to stab somebody.
Well, no doubt, and he had, you know, I mean, that's yet another reason why I think she did not participate in the murder, because there wasn't a mark on her. Lawrence had very swollen hands. Tabby had cuts, you know, cuts and bruises.
So what put her, how was she committed? Lisa.
How was Lisa, why was she
convicted?
Well, I mean, the number.
Just showing up?
Well, the number one is because Judge Stengel believed that the mother really said, Michelle did it. He relied on that, and then, you know, I mean, there was another, you know, some sweatpants were recovered. What Lisa said is that when Lisa, she's arrested and she is interrogated in the middle of the night for like 6 hours, from 2 a.m. to 8 a.m., and she told the detective that she was wearing, you know, ladies' stretch pants and a Bart Simpson t-shirt, and he typed up a report to that effect. And then at some point later, he made handwritten additions and changed the statement to reflect that Lisa was wearing sweatpants, her Lawrence's sweatpants, and a flannel shirt, which is, it just defies believability. And what Lisa said is that, you know, after this murder, they washed it, went to the laundromat and washed some Lawrence's clothes, and then they got rid of them in a dumpster, and the authorities found the sweatpants, and there was blood, you know, on the fabric of, mm-hmm. of the sweatpants. And so I think that when the investigation is being done, they realize they don't really have anything, any physical evidence on Lisa. They say, well, why don't we say that she was wearing the sweatpants? Because if she was wearing the sweatpants, then that, you know, there's blood on them, so that puts her right in the line of fire. And you know, Judge Dalzell just said it's ridiculous. I mean, Lawrence was way, you know,
and why
60.
Did Lawrence want to kill Lauren? Because she was she said that he raped her.
That's,
and she was going to go please.
I mean, that's what I believe was the motive. I mean, he was really a, you know, he date raped Lisa. Lisa walked down with the blonde. She lost her virginity with him.
And he's the guy that's free.
And he's the guy that's free. That's, yeah, exactly. And then, yes, I mean, he date, you know, date raped Laurie. And I don't know why, you know, why the authorities did not pursue that further, but I think Lawrence, obviously, it's hanging over his head that eventually he's going to be charged with a rape, and he might go to prison. And I mean, he just, you know, he physically abused Lisa. It's just, that was just a way of life for him. So
what was his relationship to Tabitha?
I mean, very good question. I mean, she, and I talk about that in the book. I mean, it's a bit mysterious. Why, you know, here is this girl. Lisa and Lawrence had only known her for 3 or 4 months. You know, they just where they were, you know, kind of new friends. And, you know, you know, Lisa knew Laurie, and the theory is that, okay, Lisa was jealous of Laurie, so she had a motive. Lawrence date raped Laurie, so he had a motive. Why in the world would Tabitha get involved in something like this? Why would she possibly go over to a girl that I, you know, I think that Tabitha and Laurie knew each other somewhat, and they might have argued in school, but that itself wasn't a motive to go over and kill her. But I mean, what I suspect in the what I argued in the book is that Tabitha was a girl, she just broken up with her boyfriend, you know, she had a tough background, low self-esteem, and, you know, Lawrence, who was a master of manipulating, you know, young girls, was probably having sex with her. That's what I suspect, and I think he was able to convince Tabitha, hey, listen, we're going to go over to Laurie's and kill her, and listen, it's known that Lisa has had a little bit of bad blood with Laurie, so she'll take, the police are going to be after her. She's going to take the fall for this. Nothing's going to happen to you. And she foolishly did it. I mean, she had to be, I mean, it's almost, I mean, one person, you know, throughout the Manson murders, that Manson was, how was Manson able to convince these, you know, young girls to go out and murder people? Just had such a spell over them, and I suspect that's what happened. I mean, I think that, you know, that I mean, he was a good-looking, tough guy, and he was able to, he had a spell over Tabitha like he did Lisa, and, you know, Lisa stuck with him for 2.5 years despite this abuse, and But yeah, it's a good question. Always.
Were drugs involved?
Lisa always straight-laced herself. She never liked alcohol, never liked drugs. Lawrence was a big drinker, but I don't think he was addicted to anything.
Drugs make you crazy.
Well, no, yeah. No doubt. I mean, I think at most maybe smoke some pot, but I don't think drugs was a minor issue, if at all. Yes?
In the process of writing the book, did you have other attorneys contest what you wrote, or after you published it, did you have other attorneys or legal system confront you as to how you wrote or why you wrote or what you wrote in the book?
Well, no. I don't think there's any question that some people disagree with what I wrote. You know, I mean, some people, you know, I mean, Lancaster, when soon after the book came out, this was early 2016, and there was an article in the Lancaster paper. It was very negative and, you know, basically saying it's all bullshit and, you know.
So you were not threatened by Lawrence?
No, I wasn't. I mean, he sent the publisher got a nasty letter from somebody that might have been Lawrence, who knows. But I mean, think about it. I mean, you know, prosecutors, they prosecute mob members. You know, do you think, you know, that has to be, I always wonder, you know, you talk about putting your life on the line, mm-hmm. you know, prosecuting John Gotti or Joey Marino, I mean, the contacts they have, but they, you know, they do it because that's what they believe, and, you know, I just wouldn't have the stomach to be a criminal lawyer. I mean, it's just the stakes are so high, and, you know, the criminal defense lawyers.
Where's Lawrence now?
It's somewhere in outside of Lancaster. I think it's New Holland, I believe, a Lancaster suburb.
He's a free man.
He is free, and, you know, I think he's got a Facebook page, and,
oh my God.
You know, and
give
yeah,
it up.
Yeah, it's. It's bad.
Absolutely.
Does his daughter have any relationship with him? The daughter that
I don't think so. I mean, I think this is, thankfully, you know, Lisa's parents have, you know, mm-hmm. kept a lid on that, and so I think he just realizes that he fathered her, but he could never be a father to her. But I think he has one of his own with his wife. I'm not certain. So, but, yeah, go ahead.
How were you able to come to your conclusions to put them, did you pray over it? Did you just use your trained attorney mind? I mean, how did you come to write what you wrote in there? You're explaining us scenarios, but how did you convince yourself? I'm not using the right words.
No, you are. I mean, I think it was my mind. I mean, I follow the case,
okay.
You know, over the years, and, you know, so I had a pretty good understanding of all the facts, and then, you know, once I really dug into, you know, I couldn't read every page of the trial transcripts, but I read all the judges' decisions,
okay.
And I just felt like, and look, reasonable minds will differ, I just think that the Judge Dalzell got it right. The other judges, just Judge Stengel and some of the appellate courts, got it wrong.
Did you say he had only practiced 2 years?
Well, Judge Stengel was—he went to high school in Lancaster, and then he was a teacher for 3 years at a Catholic school and teaching high school English. And then he decided to go to law school, and he was a lawyer for like 8 years. And then his father was a well-known lawyer in Lancaster, and, you know, politics helps you become a judge.
Because I was wondering why this man who did not have extensive background would have been permitted to try this case. It just smelled, something doesn't sound kosher.
No, it did not smell kosher to me. And I mean, I think that, I mean, the way they're supposed to do it in any court system is they randomly assign cases to judges, you know, and they picked it was Judge Stengel's turn to hear a case, mm-hmm. and even though he had only had 2 years of experience as a judge and other judges had 25 years, it was his case. So, yeah, I didn't think it was right either.
He's still a judge.
He is. I mean, good question. I mean, ironically, like he he would stayed in Lancaster as a judge until about 2004, and then he became a federal judge in Philadelphia on the same bench as Judge Dalzell. It is ironic.
Stengel.
Stengel, and then Stengel within the last year or two became the chief judge of the Eastern District of Philadelphia, which really just disgusts Lisa, it disgusts me, it disgusts Lisa, it disgusts her father. I mean, I just don't think he's worthy. But that's just the way we feel. He's...
Maybe he's a relative of Casey Stengel.
Yeah, right. I know, I thought about that. The same name, the great manager, that guy or something. Yeah. So, any thoughts? You guys have been...
Never knew of it. I've only been in this area about 15 years. We have a friend that lives in New Holland.
So oh, do you really?
She might be living near Lawrence somewhere.
Interesting. Yeah, I mean, New Holland's a pretty small town, isn't it?
What's his last name?
Yunkin, Y-U-N-K-I-N.
Yunkin.
Yeah. Butch, yeah, Lawrence goes by Butch is his nickname. And, I mean, it's just... But yeah, I know you asked me. I mean, just the passion. I just
and the fact that he's still being permitted to live in that area. I'm a teacher by trade, and other things. But today, also a realtor. Whenever people are looking for a house, they can Google certain. Areas and they'll Google certain people's names and they can see if there's a track record of offenses of a molestation.
Yeah, I knew.
I don't know why he's still being permitted or accepted to accept the community is accepting him to live in those areas.
Right, and I think sadly, I mean, I think that the people from Lancaster were just brainwashed, and if you ask 20 people in Lancaster, 19 of them are going to say, oh, look, the court said that Lawrence didn't participate in the murder. He must not have, and it doesn't matter that his ear and back was found in her hair, his bloody sneakers were, there were several different examples. They don't care. They don't care. They want to believe that Lisa was the murderer and that Lawrence did nothing more than drop the girls off. And so I think they feel like, well, it's okay to have him living in her community because he didn't kill anybody. All he did was he was the getaway driver. And that's just the way it is. And people, so, yes?
Whose night was it?
I mean, that's a good question. I don't know if the knife was bought. I mean, that's a very good question. I don't know if it was just a knife that Lisa and Lawrence had in their, and they were living in a trailer at the time it happened, but they might have had, or they might have bought one. I'm not sure.
But it wasn't Tabitha's.
I don't think it was. I don't think it was Tabitha's. Mm-hmm. But I know that when she was wearing a Miami, it was a cold morning. She had a Miami Dolphins jacket, and the tip of the knife was found in the pocket of her jacket, which is pretty convincing evidence that she had the knife. And they took a knife, they took a rope in. I mean, it was. And there was a rope found in that Susquehanna River, and they used canine dogs had a sweater from Tabitha, and her scent led the dog to the rope in the water, meaning that she was the one that had her hands on the rope. That kind of evidence is, it's just, I just thought all of the pieces of the puzzle, when I think of all the evidence and weigh it. I just feel like she really got a raw deal, and she's got long lifelines. She's grandfather died in his late 80s recently, and here she is 45 years old, and potentially could be in prison another, for decades more. And it's a, you know, even though I think she's gotten better treatment in Massachusetts than the other prisons, you know, prison is a grim life. I mean, it just is a grim life. You just get, you know, you get treated like crap, and your whole world is right there. You know, I mean, fortunately, she's not, you know, confined to a cell. She can, you know, she can go out, you know, go outside and, you know, do activities, and she, but still, it's grim. I mean, it is depressing. Like, has anybody ever been in a prison to visit, you know, for any reason?
Mm-hmm.
Yes? And grim, is there any other way to describe it?
It's a good word.
Yeah. I mean, it's depressing, and,
Did you go to some prison once when you were in college?
Well, I went to Eastern, Eastern.
I thought you went to when you were at Penn State. I thought they took you to some prison.
Okay. I mean, when you hear that door close behind, you know, whatever they call that gate.
Oh, yeah.
That, you know, that's an eerie feeling, knowing that you're leaving in an hour or two.
Yeah.
Like, just to hear that thing close. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can't imagine what it would be like to be confined in a place like that.
Absolutely. And then, I mean, especially the people on death row that have, you know, are you familiar with it?
It's a violent place.
I mean, it really is. I mean, people are angry, frustrated, and they get mistreated by the staff, and the rules don't really matter. And but you know, think about people on death row that are, you know, in their cell 23 hours a day, you know, in an 8-foot by 10-foot cell. I mean, that has to be a horrible, horrible existence. And there's been so many people, I think 150, something like that, people who have been sent to death row and then later exonerated, usually by DNA. And, you know, let's face it, those people never can have a life after spending 15, 20
years. You could give them $20 million. It's not going to make up for
it. There's absolutely right. You're right. Some of them do get millions, but they never have a normal life. I think they're always,
my son is a corrections officer in a prison in Florida.
Is that right?
And I worry about him all the time, and I'm very unhappy about it. But they moved down there because his wife's family was there, and it's a very small town, small area, and there were no really other jobs. And he's been there, I think, about 15 or 16 years.
Wow, a long time.
And it were years and years when they got no raise whatsoever. I think it was like 10 years. So they don't do really well, but he told me once that one prisoner said, don't worry if something happens, we'll have your back because you treat us well. You know, he tries to treat, not overboard or anything like that, but just be reasonable and so forth. And some of the other, you know, I guess the corrections officers
are not so nice. Well, that's commendable that your son treats them respectfully. I mean, they're human beings.
Yeah.
And I think if you give them respect, they'll be respectful back. Mm-hmm. And I mean, is it a state prison or a county prison?
It's a state.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
they
a big
got
difference.
I can't remember how many it was, hundreds of prisoners from Miami when the hurricane was the last year of the hurricane. And they didn't really have place, actually cells to put them in, so they were in a big room, you know. And then a couple times they said they're getting restless and walking around and everything. They had to have some of the people come out around the perimeter with guns and make sure they were.
He should have taken his vacation then.
They were not even allowed to go
home. Oh, I know, I'm
only
kidding.
Yeah, they were.
Yeah.
It's scary. It's very scary.
Oh,
I can't imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you or other attorneys helping? Still trying to help?
Well, yeah. Trying. The tough part is to find a lawyer, you know, an experienced criminal defense lawyer who's willing to do it pro bono. I mean, the reality is there's no money. I mean, the family was bankrupt because they spent, you know, thousands and thousands of dollars on the lawyers to file appeals, and they don't have the money. So, you know, and I've talked to various lawyers over the years, and some have expressed interest, but you know, they say to really dig into this case is going to take huge, huge amounts of time with, you know, no money and a long shot for success, and that's what's tough. She recently, you know, she wrote to this outfit in Chicago that helps wrongly convicted people, and is hoping that they may take an interest. That they, you know, the Innocence Project, you know, there's Innocence Projects, you know, all over the country, and there's one that's based in Philadelphia, and they will not take her case because they'll only take on a case if the person was 100% innocent of the crime. And because Lisa unfortunately had some involvement, they won't do it. So it's hard. I mean, you know, it's going to take.
The biggest reason she was convicted was because the mother of the murdered girl heard her say her middle name.
That's right. Before, supposedly.
Before she died. Okay, so that's your say. What was the other?
Well, that there was the, you know, the blood on the sweatpants that, again, Judge Stengel believed that Lisa was wearing that put her. And then also there were, you know, there was a witness, there was a young girl who testified at her trial, that at Lisa's trial, that Lisa said, and this girl's name was Laura, that Lisa said to Laura that she would slip, that she wants to slip the throat of Laurie. And that, now, the reality is, this girl, Laura, was, because she was, you know, after the murder occurred, you know, the authorities interviewed many people, including friends of, you know, friends of Lisa Lawrence, and Laura was interviewed by detectives about, you know, what, you know, how well did she know Lisa, and, you know, what did she say about Laurie, and none of those reports contain any reference to Laura saying that Lisa said she wanted to slit the throat of Laurie. And then, a couple months later, a report surfaced that said, a police report that Laura Thomas said that Lisa told her that she wanted to slit the throat of Laurie. And this girl, Laura, had a couple weeks before, I think between the time of the murder and the time that this, you know, this police report surfaced that said that Lisa made those incriminating statements, Laura was arrested for, you know, for making a false police report, and she created, because she came up with some ridiculous story. And you know, what Lisa's lawyers were able to convince Judge Dalzell, and he was very emphatic about this in his decision, is basically that they said, listen, Laura, we're gonna let you go on that, making the false report, but we need your help here, Lisa. Mm-hmm. And Judge Dalzell was convinced that's what happened, that Lisa never made such a statement mm-hmm. to Laura. And again, I tend to believe it, because if she really did, when Laura was initially interviewed by police, why would she not say that? It's hard to believe. And that's why, you know, the whole thing with the, you know, the Michelle did it, is that the initial police reports contain no reference to Laurie's mother saying that Laurie said Michelle did it before she died. What the police reports say is that Laurie's boyfriend at the time was a guy named Brad, and she said something like, and then Brad was over there, and she said, it was a setup, Michelle did it. In other words, she thought that call that got her out of the condo, that was supposedly from mm-hmm. the guidance counselor, but really was a ruse to get her out of the house. That was the setup that she was referring to. So there are the words, Michelle did it, mm-hmm. but that's not what Laurie said to her. That's what Laurie's mother said to Laura's boyfriend. So, and then again, there was a lot of, you know, the EMTs that appeared on the scene said that her, Laurie's carotid artery was severed. And that was horrible, but, and, you know, experts said that when that happens, the person is incapable of speech. That's absolutely right. And again, Judge Dalzell concluded emphatically that Laurie did not say that. He wasn't suggesting that Laurie's mother made it up. I don't think there's any way that she lied about that. I mean, it just had to be, as Judge Dalzell said, it had to be the worst moment of her life. I mean, horrible, mm-hmm. horrible to come back and see your only child, you know, brutally murdered on the brink of death, and she could not have been thinking rationally. And maybe she imagined Laurie said that. You know, that's what she thought in her mind. Who knows? But that's. You ask a good question. What is it that got her convicted? But
when you think about it, she was having a baby by this guy, Lawrence,
yep.
who was raped another girl. She's probably so emotional. I mean, I can see where people would think she was wanting revenge. I would have killed him, not her.
There you go.
Yeah, he's the one who deserved it. I mean, that's,
get rid of him.
Yeah. Oh yeah, he was bad.
I feel sorry for her. I don't know what's ever going to happen.
Yeah, I'm not sure, but I still talk to her times a month. I mean, I'm very sympathetic to, you know, something.
Spirit tatties and.
Yeah, she tries to maintain, you know, good spirits, and she, you know, she keeps busy and, you know, reads a lot and, you know, writes, wrote a children's story. I mean, I think that's the way you have to survive prison is just keep busy. And, but yeah, please.
Did she write most of the book?
She did. I mean, and it,
how could you put, I always apologize when I talk.
That's
I apologize
okay.
for apologizing. But anyway, how could you have permit? It just sounds so unusual that an attorney would allow a person to write, and then you just kind of, her situation, the case, from her perspective, even at how could you interject, or how did you know how to correctly interject to what she was saying?
Well, I mean, it's a good point. I mean, the way we did it is that, you know, I mean, initially, my thought initially was, I want to write this book myself. But as time went on, I said, this is going to be so time consuming because of the job and the kids and, you know, everything else. And then she had told me that she had written some chapters herself. I said, let's do a collaboration. And, you know, a lot of what she wrote was, you know, that the first probably 150 pages are by her, and she talks about some childhood memories, and then she meets Lawrence on page 20, and then that bad relationship, and they meet Tabitha, and then the day of the, you know, the day of the murder, she describes that. And then, I mean, I eventually chime in just, you know, looking at the legal issues, you know. So I was able to do that, kind of independently. You know, why is it, why did Judge Dalzell decide the way he did, and Judge Stengel decide the way he did, and, you know, some of the political issues that.
So she was comfortable with what you.
Oh, no doubt. I mean, because, you know, what we would just exchange, you know, it was an undertaking to get it done, but, you know, she would send her chapters to me, and I would send my chapters to her, and, you know, she would read them over, and making suggestions, and I would do the same with hers, and then it was edited by the. So it was a project to do that, but that's, you know, like, I gave the opportunity, you know, that whole issue with what you asked is, you know, why was Tabitha, who was she, and what, why did she have an involvement? And that's when I talked about the whole, you know, the whole issue of she must have been having a relationship with Lawrence that had to have given her the motive. And because, you know, as I said, when she testified in 1992, Tabitha, at her own trial, she declines to testify and she's convicted. She never talked to the police. She just, I understand everybody has a constitutional right to not to say anything, but eventually, when Judge Dalzell's decision was reversed and it went back to Judge Stengel in 1998, finally Tabitha emerged and testified against Lisa at, you know, at that hearing, and she and Tabitha said, oh, it was Lisa. Lisa was the aggressor. She was the murderer. Lawrence never entered the condo. And then again, I think she was just lying her head off, because again, there's so many pieces of evidence that puts Lawrence in there. And for her to say Lawrence never walked in, I can't believe a word she says. And you know, Judge Stengel, again, he had an agenda and he was biased, and in his decision he said, well, what incentive did Tabitha have to lie? Because regardless of what she said, she still had a life sentence. But I suspected that, you know, she, and I talked about that whole issue with the, you know, the movement to get life sentence for juveniles struck down. And when I was writing it, the decision had not been finalized, but I thought that maybe her lawyer had told her, listen, Tabby, listen, you need to be on the part. This is the Lisa Lambert trial, and they need to have her convicted, and you need anything you can do to help them. You might be looked upon favorably if you ever get a chance to get parole. And then sure enough, almost 20 years later, she has her day in court a couple of years ago, and the judge could have, even despite the Supreme Court's ruling, the judge still has the discretion to say the life sentence remains. If the crime was horrible enough or whatever the circumstances, but the judge opted for leniency and gave her the opportunity for parole. And I think maybe he may have considered, hey, listen, her testimony helped convict Lisa Lambert, so we're gonna return the favor to her. That's what I believe.
So is Lisa in a federal prison?
In a state prison, because it was always she's always been in state prisons. It's just the reason it ended up in federal court is because, you know, you hear about these habeas corpus petitions. That's what it was that allowed Judge Dalzell to free her. You know, when you that's, you know, when a prisoner's last resort is just to go to federal court and file a habeas. So even though it was heard in federal court, she has always been in the state prison system because her crimes were, or the crimes she was convicted of were, you know, violations of Pennsylvania law as opposed to federal law.
She should have gone to Mexico immediately.
Yeah, people, somebody, I remember somebody saying that to me when she was free for 10 months. So somebody
said a long distance.
Yeah.
In 10 months.
Yeah. No doubt. But I think her feeling was, you know, look, I got.
I didn't do it. Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't do it. My daughter is now 5 or 6 years old, and I'm going to hang in there, and I'm not going to run away from this, and everything is going to turn out. And another thing that I consider very strongly is that when in 1996, what gave rise to Judge Dalzell holding this hearing and releasing her is Lisa had been moved to the New Jersey prison because she was sexually assaulted by this guard in Pennsylvania, and he ended up going to prison himself. So she got moved to New Jersey, and Lisa hand wrote a habeas corpus petition from her cell. She writes this several page petition why she was wrongly convicted. It ends up on Judge Dalzell's desk. Judge Dalzell thinks there's merit, and he appoints this well-known firm in Philadelphia, Schneider Harrison, and two lawyers, one a woman named Christina Rainbow, one by Tina, kind of took the lead. And she wasn't a criminal lawyer by trade, but she just it interested her. And her initial thought was, oh my God, I mean, this is Lisa Lambert, she's guilty as hell, I know it. And then she went and met with Lisa and talked to her at length and said, you know, something, I think there's something, I really think she she got her all deal here, and then she and her husband, Peter, was also a lawyer with the firm. They just did an incredible investigation, and, you know, which led to her release, and they thought so highly of Lisa, I mean, they treated her like a daughter, that they lived in a, you know, townhouse in Center City. Lisa initially moved in with them after the release. And they, you know, they continue to fight for her, you know, when it got reversed by this federal appeals court and then it went back to Lancaster, they continue to represent her, and they, you know, they did so for, you know, a total of 9 years, and, you know, believing in her, you know, wholeheartedly, and I think that says a lot. They weren't criminal lawyers, they just believed, you know, believed in her and believed in her innocence, and but eventually they ended up moving to Vermont in like 2005, and I mean the last ditch effort was an appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court, who almost never hears cases, only 1% of the time they wouldn't hear Lisa's, and you know, and that was it. But for them, for two lawyers to put that much time and energy into one case, I said, boy, they must really, really believe in all their hearts that she was innocent. So, but yeah, if you know any criminal lawyers who are looking for an interesting case, please let me know, because it is tough. It's tough, and you know, it'd be tremendous to, you know, for her to get just another day in court. You know, she never had a, you know, because of that whole issue back in 1992, where she, you know, she asked for the change of venue, didn't get it, her lawyer said, waive your right to a jury trial, it was heard by a judge. You know, she's never had a jury trial. I just wonder, you know, what would 12 people, 12 impartial people, not from Lancaster, if they heard all the evidence in the case, would they convict her? I don't think they would.
Could that ever happen again?
Well, what would have to happen is, okay. Is it conceivable, but a judge would have to conclude that she's entitled to a new trial, and for that to happen, there has to be some new after discovered evidence, and so I mean, one of the things that happened, and you know, thanks for your, you guys have asked a lot of great questions. It's really made this, you know, made this interesting. But not long after I became, you know, got to know Lisa, she got a letter out of the blue from a guy that was in prison, and I mean, the long and short of it is a letter came to surface that the man that prosecuted her and just viciously back at the time of her trial was named John Kneff, and years later he became, he wanted to be the district attorney of Lancaster, and he lost, and then he just ended up going into criminal defense, which is sometimes what happens. And but he was in 2007 representing a man who has, you know, some drug charges, and they became, had kind of a friendly relationship, and this guy's name was Warren, and Warren said that Kneff told him, and this is December of 2007, that he had a guilty conscience about his conduct in Lisa Lambert's case, and confided to him, this man named Warren, and 3 months later, John Kneff died and had a stroke. You know, sad, of course, and he was 57, 58, and, you know, we suspect that he was in bad health, and, you know, had a guilty conscience about what he did, and unloaded it to this, you know, this client. And then there was a letter that Kneff had written to this Warren Raffensperger that said, and it was on, you know, again, Kneff was doing criminal defense work, he was doing work through the public defender's office, and he wrote this letter to Raffensperger that said, and this is detailed in the kind of the late stages of the book, that said, you know, I can't represent you in the, there were some drug charges or gun charges, and he said, you know, something to the effect that the Lancaster County prosecutors and judges work together to ensure, you know, ensure convictions. Is it right, morally right? No, it's not, but my hands are tied here. I can't help you out. And, you know, we thought that the combination of that letter by, you know, by Ken F. and this affidavit by Warren, this man Warren, who said Ken F. confessed to him about his misconduct of Lisa's case, would be enough to get her, you know, to get her a new trial. I mean, how often do you get the prosecutor in a murder case to admit many years later that he did bad things to ensure a conviction? But the, you know, we went through the whole up the line, you know, had to go back to Lancaster and then went, you know, appeals and didn't get any relief. And the thought was that, well, yeah, the letter from Kneff was hearsay because he's died. He can't be authenticated. Mm-hmm. You know, Warren, the guy who said that Kneff confessed to him, he's got a criminal record going back many years, so he's completely unreliable. And you know, this is all old evidence anyway. You know, that's the whole thing. You have to convince the court that this is new evidence. And we thought that this, you know, this confession, that this is really new, but the court said, well, but Lisa's always been maintaining that she was railroaded, so this is just another attempt to make that very same argument. But I thought that that might give her a chance to get, you know, to get her day in court, but unsuccessful. And it's tough. I mean, it's just tough. I mean, post-conviction appeals are so hard. 99 out of 100, the court just tends to rubber stamp the conviction, and it's tough. But yes.
To possibly going forward, how could we protect ourselves that something like this might not happen? Should we have a good circle of attorneys around us? Or should we? I don't know how to ask the question, but it just seems like any of us could be possibly vulnerable if a set of circumstances are possibly misinterpreted.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. I mean, it is scary that there's no doubt good, honest people have been convicted of crimes that they did not commit because they were the wrong place at the wrong time. And I don't know what you can do to.
But you said something that, and I'm sorry, it's been a long day for all of us, that you said that the Lancaster attorneys work with who?
Well, the letter was, you know, if I can find it, because it was, here's what the letter said. This is John Kneff, the old prosecutor, to this Warren Raffensperger. He says, "You know, as I told you of the fact that the Lancaster County District Attorney's Office dictates to all public defenders and court-appointed attorneys policy and procedures when we are appointed to defend indigent persons, and the District Attorney's Office, with the blessings of the county judges, condones this to ensure a high rate of convictions. Corrupt, yes. Ethical, no. But I do have a family and livelihood to place before your defense, and as a prior assistant district attorney, believe that I know what I'm talking about." I mean, that's pretty damning. And you know, the Lancaster District Attorney's Office said, and you know, defending it is, John Kneff would have never written that. But it's, again, you have a letterhead, his signature, that was, I mean, I think is this, you know, sometimes, you know, my secretary will sign my name and say by, you know.
Yeah, sure.
So it has John Kneff by, you know, which she would routinely do when he sent letters out. Mm-hmm. I don't know how, but they suggest that it was some kind of a forgery that Warren Raffensperger somehow typed up this letter and put it on Lancaster County, Lancaster Public Defender letterhead. I don't know how it possibly could have happened. I just don't. And I think that is, to me, is such a damning, damning statement. And when I was doing some investigating, in the process of writing the book, I talked to some lawyers in Lancaster, and I asked them what they thought about John Kenneth, the prosecutor. And two different lawyers told me that his motto as a prosecutor was, anybody can convict a guilty person. It takes a real genius to convict somebody who's innocent. And that is horrible. I mean, that's a horrible thing to say. And, when I heard it from one person, I said, maybe he didn't like Kenneth or something. But when I heard it from a second, and the second person who was friendly with Kenneth said, but he was just kidding. But come on, I mean, just to say something like that.
I think the motto here is stay out of Lancaster.
You're not kidding.
I'm not driving my drive.
No, just avoid it. That's
no way.
No, that's for sure. But it happens. That is bad. I mean, that really is bad. And I thought that, some of the petitions that were filed, the whole issue with the confession and all that is, we made mention of that, and because that supports Warren Raffensperger is saying that Kenneth confessed to him about his misconduct in Lisa's case, and that statement about willing to convict the innocent completely supports it. That he, these prosecutors, they want to notch convictions under their belts, and whether the person really did it.
It's irrelevant.
Doesn't really matter sometimes, and it's it's sad. So, yeah. Interesting. Any other? You guys have been a great audience. That's for sure.
Thank you very much.
If anybody wants a book, it's it goes for $17.95. Sell for $15.
You better read it.
I'm gonna read it.
I have to read it. Does Lisa get any visitors other than herself?
I mean, not a lot. I mean, she's had some friends from her dad was up when she graduated from college. Her dad drove up, but not a lot of visitors.
No.
I mean, I know that her daughter visits her in New Jersey, and soon after Lisa had been beaten up by an inmate, and it just Lisa's face was all. And it was very upsetting to her, and I know it's an ugly story. I mean, it's an ugly story, and I know some people read the book and say, "Oh boy, that's so depressing." And I get it. You have to have kind of a stomach to make it all the way through because it's so. Right.